back to the notion of the politics side of things, I do readings from this section quite often from Toxic, and it goes back to 1984. So the story behind Toxic is that there's a lethal substance is being smuggled into the country, and it's not been stored safely, or there's a suspicion it's not been stored safely. If this stuff in reality comes into contact with water, it's very lethal, and it caused the Bhopal disaster in 1984, the world's biggest industrial accident. Thousands and thousands of people were killed overnight in that disaster. So I've used that same substance in this story. So I've taken as the prologue to the story a setting in Bhopal itself in 1984. And it always makes me think, in 1984 we had Maggie Thatcher in number 10, we had Ronald Reagan in the White House. And have things really got better since then? It's a long time ago. Have we learned? So I'll read from that first part of the book. The sudden screaming and the commotion outside awoke the dying. It was still dark and muggy as the panicked youth scrambled from his bunk and switched on the lamp. Above the everyday stench that lingered even at this hour, his nostrils were immediately assaulted by a sharp, pungent smell that knifed into his lungs and set him coughing so that he could barely stand up. He looked around the room. Mo was gone. He clawed open the shack door. Immediately the smell and his choking grew worse, his grey eyes burning red and beginning to water. A heavy punch landed on his chest and he found himself propelled back into the room. Quick, get this on, he heard Mo's voice, muffled and strange, but he failed to understand what she was saying. His head was grabbed, his arms flailed in terror, his face was squeezed into something tight. He caught his breath. He was panting like a cornered animal. Are you okay? Can you breathe? Panic in her voice, muffled through the gas mask. The masks had been a source of ridicule when he and Mo had first arrived here, when the overly enthusiastic curator of the planned 16th Punjab Regiment Museum had brought them the crate of wartime relics to document. Now the sight of the mask made him cry out in alarm, but when he focused on what was beyond the door, he recoiled in horror and had to force down the bile that came to his throat. The shanty suburb that lined the walls of the Union Carbide plant was enveloped in a mass of plume smoke. And through the haze, he heard clearly the shrieks and the stampeding that had broken into his sleep. There were thousands of people on the street, and they were all running, crying, wailing. He pressed himself against the shack wall, breathing hard inside his gas mask. There's been a leak from the plant, said Mo. Come on. She tugged at his arm. Had she come back to help him because she cared about him, he wondered, or did she just need somebody to do her dirty work for her? When they'd set out together on their gap year travels, things had been good between them. But she'd grown cold towards him, bossy. He didn't like it. What kind of a man was he turning into, jumping to her beck and call? Then the smoke was all around him. A surge of adrenaline sent him towards the road. Arms and shoulders barged into him through the fog. He began to run alongside them, fighting to keep his balance in all the jostling. Then his foot caught on something large and he sprawled face first into the dust. From the level of the ground, he examined the road surface. It was littered with dead and dying people and animals. Bare feet, sandals and sand shoes were pounding all around him. He'd tripped over a bakra, a huge ugly goat. Its eyes were fixed wide, its tongue protruding and already covered in dust. He slowly stood up, appalled. Stumbling through the toxic gas cloud, his own breathing loud in the mask, he scrambled over still bodies and writhing ones. Patches of the chaos around him emerged through the mist, and he saw the futile attempts of a street beggar to hold on to the bare threads of life. He stared transfixed as the man's last breaths were exhaled and life extinguished. Then the fog rolled past again and hid the terrible sight, as the running crowds set him along the road once more. He breathed into the mask deeply, easily, powerfully. He twisted away in disgust from the grasping hands of a woman whose eyes were opaque and weeping, her gaping mouth uttering silent screams of agony from lungs torn by the poisonous air. The woman reached out, grasping desperately. He stumbled on, looking back at her with revulsion. The stampeding and the shouting, screaming, terrified chaos and the blinding fog continued amok. He stopped. Nobody was going to help her. He turned back and looked at the woman again. She heard his footsteps approach and she reached up for him, her rasping breath uttering incoherent pleas. He saw her dirty fingernails, like those who constantly jabbed and picked at his clothing. Those women in bare feet and filthy rags and their ceaseless laughing at him and his skinny pale frame. Well, they wouldn't be laughing at him now, he thought, as he felt the rush of blood in his veins. With the first stirrings of arousal, he dragged the blinded woman behind an oil drum. Testosterone flooded his head at her shocked expression as he kicked her legs apart. He would teach these bitches a lesson, and then he would return home, a man. On the morning of December the 4th, 1984, municipal workers in Bhopal, India, were clearing some 4,000 dead bodies and thousands of animal carcasses from the streets following the world's worst industrial accident. The toxic cloud that caused the massive death toll formed when water poured into a tank of improperly stored methyl isocyanate, MIC. It doesn't look dangerous, and you can't smell it till it's too late. You can only hope it's not sitting around anywhere near you.